Start off by giving thanks to our Father in Heaven for making this series of events possible. Okay, our guest speaker tonight, Ms.Ong and the sponsors and all our invited guests here for taking time out this evening to attend this event. Indeed, we are deeply honored. Okay, so kindly allow me to run through the program for today. Okay. We will start with an opening speech by Mr. David Po, someone whose name needs no mention. He's the founder of this non-profit organization, God is my CEO, in short, GIMC. There will be a presentation by World Vision International, a humanitarian relief organization dedicated working with children, families, and communities worldwide. Followed by our guest speaker, Ms.Ong will deliver her speech on wisdom in leadership, entrepreneurship, and wealth creation. Last but not least, there will be a question and answer session. Okay. Without further ado, let me introduce Mr. David Po, who is the CEO and Managing Director of Asia Wisdom Group and DP Group of companies, which are all real estate related businesses. Early last year, David had a calling to do something to give back and bring glory to God's name. Hence, he founded GIMC to advance God's kingdom. Being a business leader, entrepreneur, and investor, he feels the importance of Christian values as the compass in our daily life. Thus, the birth of God is my CEO and all of us here this evening. With a warm applause, let's invite David up on stage for his opening speech. Ladies and gentlemen, please help me welcome Mr. David Po.
Hello, hi. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Good evening, all of you.
Good evening.
Oh, that's not good enough, huh? Because I thought you just had a dinner. I think you all can do better, right? Thank you so much. So let's do it one more time, huh? Okay, show me you all can do better. Good evening, friends.
Good evening.
Good. Sounds better. Good. Huh? Sounds that you have just look now. Sounds that you have just had your dinner. Good. Now, okay. Some of you I see all quite in most of our events. I'm very happy that you come back again. Now, let me share why is GIMC here. In short, God is my CEO. Okay, as my friend or colleague Dixon has actually mentioned, this is actually my non-profit company. Okay, non-profit means it's not for profit. I'm a young Christian. Okay, I accepted Christ. This is my fifth year. This is the best decision of my lifetime. I should have done it earlier. And God has given me so much. And I feel that I think I should do more for Father. Huh? Okay, so I set up this non-profit arm. This is actually a platform not just for believers but for non-believers too. Now, in the last 1 year, we have actually organized quite a few management talks, huh? And I'm quite sure maybe 50% of these audiences are actually pre-believers, which is good because anyone can be here to attend our talk. Why? If you do realize, our topic is always wisdom in leadership, entrepreneurship, and wealth creation. Right, so it's for believers and pre-believers. That is to say, if you are, you can be here, whether you are a leader, an entrepreneur, or you are a manager, or you are an employer, or even an employee, you can be here to learn how you actually build wealth in a proper, legal, ethical manner using God's words. Okay, now, what do we do? In the last 1 year plus minor, we've actually organized quite a few management talks. Now, who are our speakers for those who are here first time? We started with Mr. Philip Ng, CEO of Far East Organization, the richest man in Singapore. We are so glad that God opened this door for him to actually give a talk about a year ago. Then later on, we have the president of GIC, one of the biggest companies owned by the Singapore government, GIC, the president, Mr. Lim Siong Guan, followed by the CEO of OUE, Mr. Lim, Teo Kim Hock, and of course today we have Mrs. Ong Mai Boon, right? So we'll continue. This one, our platform will continue to invite prominent leaders or managers in the market to be here to share with believers and pre-believers how you actually manage your team, how do you run your company, how do you actually serve your team, how do you develop your team's potential, how do you make money. No. So these are things that they will share. And there'll be a lot to learn, not just for believers, but also pre-believers. So please continue coming and join us for this event. Right? And having said it's non-profit, of course, okay, currently this is actually self-funded. This company is self-funded. So God bless again. We manage our sponsors like Mr. Philip Ng is very, very generous. God is great. His Singapore richest man, and he's a Christian. He's a great Christian. And he has been sponsoring most of our events. Okay, that's why we can continue running our events. Okay, so we welcome volunteers. We welcome volunteers who would like to help out in some of our events. Please let us know. We even we even appreciate sponsorship. If, for example, if we own a catering company, say, hey, David, can I sponsor some of your catering? Sure, please, by all means, we are happy to hear from you. Right, now, again, why GIMC? Okay, it's about how entrepreneurs run their company, how leaders lead their team, how managers manage, how employees make their money. Oh, you're just an investor, you do nothing except investing for your living. Then we also like to share with you how you should invest in an ethical manner in God's words. For example, I think you have heard enough last year, there are two gold guarantee companies that closed down. And plenty of Singaporeans lost their money, lost their savings. They bought gold through them and then they closed down, they lost all the savings. But why is this so? Because they believe, all these investors believe there's free lunches in this world. God has never promised free lunches. God promised to provide, but God has never promised free lunches. God wants you to act wisely. God wants you to work hard. Right? But all these people believe this. Oh, they promise such a high return and they believe it's real. So when they invest gold with them, they close down, they lost all their savings. So again, this is also part of GIMC. We want to educate not just leaders, entrepreneurs, but even investors. Please invest your money wisely. No matter what you do to build your wealth, please do it legally, ethically, and in God's way. Right? That is what GIMC is all about. Now, I will not repeat too much about what GIMC is all about, because I've said in the last few rounds, and I know some of you have heard it a few times, so I'll cut it short. Okay? But still, okay? There are many ways we can apply God's word when we actually make our living. Okay, and today I'm going to actually pick a very a special topic which you don't find very often in Singapore. David, you mean pollution? You find a lot in Singapore. Where do pollution? Singapore, blue sky, all the 365 days, unless on months where haze is blown here or whatever. Okay, but I want to share with you something about pollution today, and to further enhance what GIMC is all about. Okay, now. There are many good reasons why I cannot stop declaring that. I think there are many things we can learn from God's words that how we can attribute our wealth. So there are many good reasons for it. But today I want to focus on how we can apply God's values in stopping pollution. Now, okay, some of you have watched this video, but I'm going to show it to you again. Of course, I won't show you the whole video. It's about 1 hour. I'm going to show you probably just 5 minutes of it. Now, this is a video, very interesting video. I think it's many people are watching over the YouTube. Now, this video is about this lady called Chai Jing. Now, she's a journalist in China. She stopped work to look after her daughter, and she spent 1 year producing this documentary about pollution in China. Now, why she did that? She actually produces documentary because when she gave birth to her daughter was born with lung cancer. Can you imagine a baby once delivered? Huh? Doctor tell the mother, say, your daughter got lung cancer. All because of pollution in China. So she decided that I want to do this documentary. Right? So this is why we have this. It's a very interesting documentary. I can only show you 5 minutes, but I wish that many of you you can actually watch it on your own. If you're not very good in Chinese, don't worry. Pick a version that's with the English subtitles, right? So I suggest maybe we sit back for the next 5 minutes. Let me show you this video. Then I'll touch more on GIMC. Thank you.
就像2013年1月份北京的PM2.5曲线，一个月里头25天雾霾。我当时在北京，在我这一年里反复看这条曲线的时候，想回忆当时有什么印象、什么感觉，但是记不起来。那时候大家都说好像这场雾霾是偶然的气象原因导致的，就没当回事儿。那个月里头我还去了4个地方出差，陕西、河南、江西、浙江。回头看势必有天空。 当时的中国正被卷入一场覆盖了25个省市和6亿人的大雾霾，但我置身其中浑然无觉。只有我的嗓子有印象，在西安那天晚上就渴得睡不着觉，我就切了一只柠檬放在枕头边上。回到北京之后，我知道我怀孕了。这时我就觉得她应该是个小女孩，因为我觉得是像个童话头。 听到他的心跳的那一瞬间，我觉得比对他没有任何别的期望，健康就好。但是，他被诊断为良性肿瘤，在出生之后就要接受手术。做麻醉之前，医生对我说，他这么小的年纪做全身麻醉是有可能醒不过来的，你要有个心理上的准备。我还没有来得及抱他一下，他就被抱走了。 后来护士在我手里放了这只小熊，那是用来安慰小孩的。他用来安慰我。我再见到我女儿的时候，她还在昏迷。医生对我说：“球球很成功，但有一件事情你要原谅我，她说她太胖了，所以刚才麻醉的时候我们扎了好多针眼才找到静脉。”我就拿着那个满着针眼的小手放在我脸上，叫她的名字。 直到他睁开眼睛看了我一眼，我是一个非常幸运的人。后来我辞职，陪伴他，照顾他，只要一家人在一起平安就好，健康就好。但是回家的路上，我就已经开始感到害怕了，全是烟熏火燎的味儿。我就拿一个手绢捂在他鼻子上，这样做很蠢，因为他会挣扎，就会呼吸得更多。 以前我从来没有对污染感到过害怕，去哪儿我都没戴过口罩。现在有个生命抱在你怀里，他呼吸，他吃，他喝，都要有你来负责，你才会感到害怕。那场雾霾持续了差不多2个月，它让我意识到这件事情不是偶然发生，也不可能很快过去。它就是我10年前在山西生活的时候我看到的天空。
每天都这样，每天每天都是这样。一个不锻炼，不刺激剧烈，你像那些狗病的话，强制，时间长了以后，人体体内就负极，负极到一定的程度，就产生了致癌的风险。
你感觉这还是？
不是核，是误区，这个已经是误区，你要觉得下来，人体超标是2个级。
真正的星星吗？没有。你见过蓝颜色的天吗？
见过蓝一点的。
你见过白云吗？没有。2004年，我采访这个6岁的小女孩的时候。 无论如何，我都没想到，他所说的，就是我女儿可能会面临的一个世界。这是2014年，整整一年的北京，只有空气优和凉的时候，我才能带她出门。但是这样的天能有多少呢？污染天数175天，这意味着一年当中有一半的时间，我不得不把她像囚徒一样关在家里面。10年前，那个环保局长对我说了一句话，效益是山西的缩影。 山西是中国的缩影，短短10年，我眼睁睁地看着它成为现实。 以前我看过一个电视剧叫《穹顶之下》，他说的是一个小镇上被突然天外飞来一个穹顶，扣在底下，与世隔绝，不能出来。但有一天，我发现我们就生活在这样的现实里。有的时候早上醒来，会看到女儿站在阳台前面，用手拍着玻璃，用这个方式告诉我她想出去。她总有一天会问我：“妈妈为什么你要把我关起来？外面到底是什么？”她会伤害我吗？ 这一年当中，我做的所有的事情就是为了回答将来他会问我的问题：雾霾是什么？他从哪儿来？我们怎么办？Friends,
this is a very okay. I think interesting is not a very good word to describe this, but I think it's a very informative video. You should actually search it on YouTube and watch the full version now. Let's touch on this topic called pollution. Can you imagine if when someone, her daughter is born with a tumor in the lung, and all because of the environment that he lives in? Now, class, why is there so much pollution in China? I watched the one-hour video because part of the reason is because there's a lack of knowledge. Many Chinese do not know what they do or did will cause harm to others. And some know that it is actually harmful to others, but they do not know how to prevent it. So lack of knowledge. Next is a lack of standards or law. There's no law saying that you cannot do it. Or the standard is not high enough. No, the standard is not high enough. Maybe it's like 30, 40 years ago Singapore, that kind of standard. Right? The standard may not be high enough, right? Lack of control and enforcement. Even the law will say that you cannot do this, but no one control, no one enforce it. That's all described. That's what you can see in the video. No one enforce it, even though someone said you cannot do this. No one can. Okay? And of course, many other reasons. But I'm going to stress on one big reason or big issue today. One of the major causes of pollution in China is because of businessmen profiteering at the expense of human life. They don't care. I just want to make my money. I'm too poor in the last 20 years. Please, give me a chance to make money. They don't care. So let's touch on this issue. Huh? This businessman trying to profit at the expense of human life. Now, how? Your factories discharging waste into water or into the air. They don't care. The chimney from the factory, cement factory, steel factory, they don't care. They don't care about it. I just want to make money. You have cars and vehicles exhaust in China, which is a big issue now. In Beijing especially, study has found that most of the pollution in Beijing is caused by car emission. Now, then David, why don't they have better standard? Sure. Okay, I'll give you an example later on why they don't have a better standard. Like, you know what we're talking about now, Euro 5, right? Singapore is talking about Euro 5, right? So why don't they have a single standard? Okay, I'm going to explain to you why shortly, why they don't have. Power station using coal for power generation. You know, 70% of China, you know, they grew by double digits over the last 20, 30 years. And they need a lot of energy. And 70% of their energy came from burning coal. No, there's a study in the video they also show. No, even in England, they also burn coal. But why they don't emit so much pollutants? But why China won't emit so much pollutants? Because the British use a clean coal. But Chinese, they don't care. As cheap as possible, whatever can burn, I'll burn. No? So it's a different kind of mentality. Okay. So, this and many reasons why or how businessmen, they just don't care. I just want to make my bucks. I don't care if what I do will harm someone. Okay, let me give you one example which I saw in that video. Okay, now in China, do they have car exhaust emissions standard? They do have. Okay, I don't know what's US standard, but you know, Europe and many of the Asia countries, they practice the Euro standard. Right now, I think it's Euro 5. Right? China, they have the national standard, national 1, national 2, but now Euro is 1, 2, 3, 4, I think now 5. Now, currently, the Chinese government also say, okay, especially trucks, you know, trucks who, you know, use diesel, a lot of emission. The trucks that he use, they have to meet Euro 4 standard. And if you go and buy a truck from the car showroom, there will be stickers sticking there. Approved Euro 4. But then, after some investigation, Chinese realized 90% of all trucks in China are not up to standard. They are all fake, so-called fake imitation, like fake LV bag. It's not real one. When it pays Euro 4, it's not Euro 4. Maybe it's Euro 1 or 2 only. That's why the emission is crazy. So she actually rang up one of the car, so-called the truck dealer, and said, "Hey, do you know that your truck that you sell is not Euro 4? Like, it's probably Euro 1 or 2 only. But why you paste the Euro 4 sticker on your truck, so that people believe it's Euro 4? You know what the dealer say? "Oh, sorry, I pasted wrongly." "Okay." Then she continued to ask, "If you have pasted wrongly, then why do you still want to sell?" "Oh, because someone want to buy." So he sell. Okay. Then she further asked, "Would you stop selling all these trucks?" He said, "I will only stop selling all these trucks if all my competitors stop selling this kind of truck. If they sell fake, I sell real, I will die. All buy fake because it's cheaper." So he's so frank about it. He said, "How I sell the real Euro 4? It's so costly. Who's going to buy from me? I will close down. Because all my competitors all sell fake. Pays a sticker, Euro 4, but it's all fake, Euro 1 or 2 only." So he said, how do you expect me to sell real Euro 4? So that's a problem. They don't care. Nobody cares. The factories don't care. Right? Just manufacture a lorry with Euro 1 or 2 standard, they just pay and say Euro 4. Now class, the question is, why are all these things happening? I respect Chinese. Okay, I respect Chinese. I know you're very hardworking, very nice people. I'm just now trying to focus on the pollution issue and not about Chinese or China. Now class, why are all these things happening in China? If you do remember, I raised it in the last few GIMC sessions. All these things are happening in China because this is what the Chinese believe. Look, who knows? Even if someone knows, I may not be caught there. Even I'm caught, I can spend money to solve the problem one, and it's okay one. That's like, 90% of them are doing worse. According to the video, it's 90% of all the trucks are all substandard, state so-called fixed. Now class, why are you and me not doing it? Because we know we are not just governed by law. We are governed by Him. God will punish me even if the law don't punish me. He will punish me. I'm not going to do it. So there's a difference. There's a difference between you and me and them. They only know one thing. The law may not be able to stop me. And the only thing they can do is use law against me. But we are different. We know God will punish us even if the law don't punish us. So for us, it's out. No way. No way we're going to do something that because just we're not making money, we will cause someone alive. A baby that's born with lung tumor. Have you heard of it? Have you heard of it in Singapore? Never once, right? Where got such thing one? But in China, it's so common. Because of the environment, is a pollution. Now class, this is what GMC is all about. Trying to educate businessmen, entrepreneurs, leaders, managers, employers, whoever who make money. Let me use a very layman term. We're trying to educate. When you make money, please be able to sleep well in the night. If you cannot sleep well, don't make the money. That's a very layman way of saying, because I know there are pre-believers in this room, so I want to use it. I want to express it very laymanly. But of course, to us believers, let's make money in God's way. That is what GMC is all about. So I hope you can continue to support GMC by coming to the event. Bring your friends. Bring your colleagues. Tell them, hey, this is not just for believers. It's for anyone to learn how you should make money ethically, legally, and in God's way. Now, that's for China. We pray for them. We pray for them. This is Beijing sky, skyline. More than half a year, it's always gray. But sometime last year, they have continuously many days of blue. You know why? Because APEC was there. APEC, it was so blue for the, don't know, 1-2 weeks. APEC was there. You know how they make the sky blue during APEC? You know about it. They declare public holiday for that few days of meeting. You know about it. They declare public holiday. So no one's going to go to school. No one's going to work. And they ban a lot of vehicles onto the road. A lot of vehicles cannot go onto the road on that few days. So the whole sky turned blue for that APEC. But the thing is, actually, this APEC blue has now, it's a jargon in China. They call it APEC Lan, APEC blue. Because the president, Xi Jinping, President Xi, has said in his speech that he hoped the APEC blue sky can continue after APEC. Okay? Right. So we pray for them that businessmen will be educated, you'll do the right thing. Pollution is not something they can resolve overnight, but over years. I hope by then, Beijing sky will be like that every day, every day. Okay, this is not to be taken for granted because I was driving that day and I saw, wow, our sky, Singapore skyline are so blue. I said, wow. We really must thank our government for the strict control, the foresight to ensure that our sky remain blue, not just for us, but for our future generation. So my son or daughter can see this, oh, daddy, I know what blue sky all about. Okay, I was driving, wow, our sky is real blue, the cloud is real white. But not to be taken for granted, many countries or cities have not seen blue sky for a long, long time. And hoping that GIMC can contribute a small effort in this. Now, what about in Singapore? Maybe in Singapore we got pollution problem except the haze period. Now, we got no problem. Sure, I agree. Okay, friends, I agree there's no problem in Singapore for pollution. But what's our problem? Even though we have no pollution problem, we have other problems. Which I think GIMC is still useful. God is my CEO, is still useful. Now, what are the problems? Let me show you. Okay. Car firm owner in 3.6 million deposit case, not in Singapore. You know about this, This car firm, of course, I say this, everyone is innocent until proven guilty, right? Now, so I'm not saying that anyone is guilty. Now, this car firm, it collected many millions of car deposits for people to buy a car. After that, he disappeared. And about 90 buyers did not get their car delivered. Now, let me ask you, you think even if the police cannot catch him, so-called, layman, I cannot catch him, do you think God will judge? Not for us to judge, but I think God will judge. Now, business group director fined for taking bread again. It's no-no. No-no in the Bible. No bribery. Okay, but we see this quite often in Swiss time. 3 months jail for cheating insurer with fake accident. A jobless man, maybe desperate for money, fake an accident and cheated an insurance company. You see, God will judge because it's 3 months jail now. Former CEO falsified accounts and cheated bank of 2.6 million. CEO running a company, not a small company, but fake his account to get a loan from a bank, and now, again, God has judged. Jailed for cheating 95 people of 300,000 over phone contracts. Young guy, with no proper guidance, finding his way of making money, but now in big trouble. 8 fire after tainted pork enters market. Okay. Pork with highly contagious virus enter China market. I think anyone who believes God will punish will never do that. Because we know He knows. Subway props reports of doctor food labor. Franchisee, maybe trying to increase the profit. Not wanting to throw away expired food. doctoring the labor, doctoring the expiry labor. Okay? ATM withdrawal fraud. Man pocketed retiree's money. A retiree trusted his friend to always withdraw money for him, but every time he go to the ATM, he withdraw maybe $100 extra for himself. Not class. Okay? Property agent jailed for forgery, embezzling 38,000. Okay? Kept his client's renter for his own. Again, in trouble now? Not class. It is some example, and this is only about in the last one, two months. You can pick up a lot of stories actually in the paper telling you actually, even though we have no pollution problem, doesn't mean we don't have a problem, no? We still have a lot of problems. A lot of people are still not making money the right way, you know. They still will make money, that night time they cannot sleep, they still will make, even though they cannot sleep well in the night, they still make. Hoping that you can reach out to your friends, educate them how they should make their money. Now, on the other hand, we have good Christian brothers and sisters, Methodists, to help the poor clear their debts. Our good Christian brothers and sisters raising money to help the poor pay their debts. Wow. This is God's word. This is God's word. Right? Now, this is what I have for you for today. My part. Before we invite our guest speaker today, Mrs. Ong, Sister Ai Boon, to give a talk to share with you, let me just invite next party to come out to share with you something. Now, the next party is not here to sell you anything, don't get me wrong, we are not trying to sell you anything. Okay. But I think I want to share this with you so that hopefully as many of you can be part of this. And I told you in my last few GIMC event, I'm going to repeat and ask them to come out again, come out again, come out again. I don't care. Even though you say, David, you'll be coming the last few times. Yes, I know. But I think it's important. It's important they are here again, after again, after again. So please bear with me. Please bear with us. If you can, do something for them. Now, who are they? These are my sponsored children. Okay? I have kids all over the world. Okay? Sounds like I'm an international playboy, right? But I'm not. Okay, these are just my sponsored kids. Now, coincidentally, they're all from China. Now, what is this all about? Let me share with you my journey with World Vision. Now, World Vision is actually an international organization. It's not a Singapore one, it's an international organization. It's actually backed by Christianity values. Okay? They go all out to help the children under the poverty line, all over the world, not just in Singapore, but all over the world. Okay. How I started with them, 10 years ago, I was shopping in Wheelock Place, and you know, that was a Borders bookshop, so they actually have a small table outside the bookshop, and I think two person was manning the so-called the store or the booth. So I went over and said, hey, what is this all about? And interesting, there are a lot of kids' photos on the table for you to see, hey, which one you want to sponsor? No, you look at them, so cute, huh? So I started my very first one 10 years ago. And the good thing is this, you can write to them, you can write to them and they write to you. You know, in those parts of the world, there's no computer, and so you don't expect emails. You write one, no? And this is the only time I learned how to do letter writing, no? Because I think most of you have lost your skill. So I think it's a good thing if you sponsor the kids, get your kids to write to them. It's real letter writing, you must write letter to them, send my post, then they will also write letters to you, and so interesting, huh? It's something that in today's model is lost, okay? And every half, or every 1 year, or half a year, I can't remember, they will send you their progress report. They will tell you, hey, this kid is now, how is he, healthy, and they'll send you the photo of this kid as well. So every year they say, hey, this kid grew up, like, hey, he's growing up, and by the age of 16, they will write to you, and what we should write to you, okay, he's independent, so-called, huh? He's now independent, you can now sponsor other kids. So you really see all these kids growing up. So I started with one, then two, then four, eight, now it's about 10 over. Okay. Because I think God bless me, hoping I can be a blessing to others. Okay. Now, I'm so happy to do all this for Father and for them. Now, let me ask you one thing. So I asked, how much do I need to so-called come up every month for the sponsorship, they told me $45 a month. Honestly, ask yourself this. What can you do with $45 right now in Singapore? Nothing. I keep on telling you, it's not even enough for a family meal, unless you go McDonald's. But for $45 a month, you can give those kids five things. Education, clean water, medical attention, teaching them economic skill, and Fiona, can I have one more? Health, okay, healthcare, education, economic skill, clean water, and food. Wow! $45, I can give this kid so much in a month. One of our meals, most of the meals are even more than $45, your family meals. But you can give them so much, no? So I say, hey, that's a good thing to do, no? Now, let me share this. I've shared before, I want to share this again. Lives are all about choices. God bless, we are so fortunate we have choices. I'll tell you why. You choose to send your daughter to Nanyang Primary School. You choose to send your son to Hua Chong. Your son is choosing between Nike or Adidas. Your daughter is choosing between iPad or a Samsung Note. But let me tell you, these poor kids don't even have a choice. You are born there, you remain poor. No choice for you. What do they have? Nothing. Their parents keep on farming every day. And they grew up to take over the farming. Class. They're not even choosing between Nike or Adidas, no. They only choose to go to school, no. And I'm not choosing between Hua Chong or Raffles. I'm just choosing to go to a school that I can learn. And I tell you, how much they treasure going to school. In those remote areas of the world, they have to walk 1-2 hours to school every day and walk 1-2 hours back home after school every day. And they are still willing to do it, no. Walk to school 1-2 hours, walk to school, back 1-2 hours, and they are okay because I just want to learn. They don't even have a choice to say, I want to go to school because they are born there. Give them a choice, a very simple choice, like, can I go to school? Not Nike, not Adidas. Do your part for them. It's a blessing that we are all here today. God bless you, hoping you can actually bless others. Now class, and the good thing is, for World Vision, it's across religions, races, it's even across countries, because you can choose to sponsor any kids from any country. You can like Africa, you can sponsor kids in Africa. You like China, you can sponsor kids there. You like Mongolia, you can sponsor kids. You like India, you can sponsor kids there. So everywhere, any countries, any religion, you can do it. And when I first started sponsoring my first kid 10 years ago, I'm actually another religion. I told you, my one Christian, I only accepted Christ 5 years ago. Best decision of my time. So if anybody can do it, you know, across religion, races, countries. So please, do your part. Right? So they are here. Now, I'd like to, before I invite Sister Ibon, I'd like to actually invite my partner from World Vision, Fiona, to share with you what World Vision is all about in the next 15 minutes. So please welcome Fiona and the team from World Vision. Thank you so much. Thanks. Thank you.
Thank you, David. Whenever we think about doing work and doing it God's way, I think what comes to mind about World Vision's work is we are about empowering the weak and the poor. We are about asking ourselves, how is it in this world of plenty there are still hungry children, those dying from preventable diseases like diarrhea? How is it in this world of plenty, there's such gross discrepancies where the wealth is held by 50% of the wealth is held by only like a small 1%. And then we ask ourselves, why are these people suffering? Is it because they are lazy? These parents of the poor children, are they lazy? And later on, I'll share a little bit more about our World Vision work. But to me, work in God's way is about empowering the weak and the poor. It's also about the language of unconditional love. Many of these children, when they understand that they've been provided for by a stranger all across the miles, and they wonder, what's the agenda? What's in it for them? We are not wanting to buy votes. We are apolitical. We rise above that. We just do it because it's the right thing to do and we can do it. And that's as simple a message as possible, that unconditional love is a reality. And the third thing about how we can work in God's way is, do we care enough to help or are we indifferent? The opposite of love is no longer hatred. The opposite of love is just indifference. In layman terms, it's just bochap. So if we do know there are all these suffering children, what is it that we can do? And this is an awareness talk. So as David has said, that we focus on helping vulnerable children, families and the communities to alleviate the poverty and the injustice, and we serve all people regardless of race, language or religion. Our faith motivates us to keep giving this unconditional love. And we have been around for, worldwide, we have been around for over 60 years. So the poverty, this is recent stats from UNICEF. Hunger, 3.1 million dying from hunger. Here we worry about cholesterol problem, right? And there they worry about whether they even have enough protein, enough food, enough nutrition, and food security for more than 3 months a year. We worry about whether our children, they have, you know, which eatery they want to go to. But the parents in, for example, Nepal, these farmers, they worry if their children are 6 months food secure because there's rice that can be harvested in 6 months. But beyond that, their children would have two main meals a day, or worse still, only one main meal a day. And here we are worried about which buffet to go to. So this is something that is so jarring, even access to clean, safe drinking water. I think our parents' time, they had something called worms in their tummy. They can eat no fat, right, because they had worms in their tummy. In this day and age, these kids still have worms in their tummy. They're not in Singapore, because in Singapore there's PUB, right? You just turn on the tap. We take clean water for granted. In the driest months of the year, people are using more water than ever. But over there, even if it looks clean, there are parasites in there, because it's not to the standard that little children can withstand. And to die from diarrhea is very sad. But it still happens. When we talk about preventable diseases, we're not talking about dying from leukemia, dying from cancer. These children don't live to celebrate their fifth birthday because they die from pneumonia, they die from diarrhea. And who has ever heard, like, purged to death? But maybe our parents, our grandparents in Singapore. This is our 50th year. We have, thankfully, that strong government and the work and the diligent population. But going back to the years, 50 years back, our forefathers, many of them were struggling with some of these things. And to have children dying from these preventable diseases is such a waste. It's a waste of life, because with so little, you can even save a life. Education, 121 million children between 6 and 15 have never been to school. Why? Because they're born there. They're not born to your family and mine. And they're not born in Singapore. Did they choose their home? Not really. Did they choose their parents? Not really. But they might be born in a family where they just have to quit school because they'll go out and work and help the rest of the siblings. Otherwise, there's not enough to eat. They've got to, at sec one, go off to a garment factory, put themselves, their lives at risk when they work out in the cities when they're only 13 years old or 14 years old. So that's the reality, and from Singapore, you can help children from Africa to the Middle East to Asia. And in Asia, you can go to all these other places that you sponsor your children with. Every month, World Vision organizes a trip where you can see your own sponsored child and see the development in the communities. Belinda Lee is her latest World Vision ambassador, and she talks about her trip to Nepal and the children that she sponsored from Cambodia as well as Nepal.
Help! They need help. So are you willing to help them? Bless them, because, you know, because we are so blessed ourselves. So when you are blessed, why not be a blessing to someone else? Excited about this trip because this is my first time going on a World Vision trip because I just got appointed as a Google Ambassador for World Vision. I brought a lot of goodies for Pramila and her family. It's like a whole bag of fleece jacket. I made a very special gift for Pramila. It's going to be awesome. I'm so excited to meet her and her family. A lot of my friends, they are World Vision sponsors, and I only came on board a few months ago, and I could never understand the kind of excitement that they had when they were sponsoring children, and I could only listen. But now I'm one of the sponsors. Deep down in my heart, I know that I'm not just helping one kid, I'm helping an entire village. And you know what? It's not about the money, but it's really about having the desire to want to do your part for the society, for the poor, for the underprivileged. And this is what I think sponsorship is all about. It's not just about one person, but it's about the whole community. You know what? Throughout the trip, I thought to myself, oh, Belinda, you're this, you know, trouble host. You know, you've been there, done that. You've seen it all. You wouldn't be feeling too much. I was wrong. I was overwhelmed.
Belinda.
Oh. I got emotional. I did. You know, she lives high up in the mountains. I live in a city. I live in a first world country. She lives in a third world country. It's a big difference. Just by giving her that sense of hope, knowing that someone cares enough to want to bless her and her family, I sincerely hope that when she grows up, she remembers that, oh, someone has helped me before. And I want to grow up to be somebody who can be a blessing to someone else. I know that they are struggling. Yeah. They've got like 6 children in a family. Their old house was destroyed by a landslide. So the dad had to go loan money to build a new house. He's heavily in debt. And in order to clear those debts, he has to go loan more money from someone else. How does he survive? How does he make sure that he keeps his whole family full and happy? And you know, it's difficult. But what happens after that? But how, when she lives here? What can we do for her? I want to do more. What would help is that we get a lot of sponsors to come into the village to sponsor every kid. Then something happens.
Yesterday we were in Sindeli East and we had to drive 2 hours or 3 hours or walk 3 hours up a very steep mountain. The terrain is extremely difficult. So imagine that you're pregnant and you're having to walk straight up a mountain in the heat of the sun to get health care. That's a huge issue here. The number of birthing centers are few and far between. And for that reason, and also culturally, women have tended to give birth at home without any help. So right now in Nepal, only 36% of women give birth with a skilled birth attendant available. That means over 60% are giving birth at home. Our NGO partner goes from village to village, building awareness, you know, urging women who are pregnant to go to clinics. They give them basic health information. They talk to them about nutrition, because nutrition when a woman is pregnant is incredibly important, both for the health of the mother and the child. We're also, at the same time, we advocate for an increased number of birthing centers. Education for children in Nepal is a real challenge. As you know, yesterday we were up in the mountains, and those little children have to walk over an hour, some of them, to get to school. Over very difficult terrain, narrow roads in the rainy season, the roads get washed out. It actually becomes dangerous to go to school. We're very involved in early child development. That's preschool, it's up to the age of 6 in Sindeli. And that's really important because what we found is that when children have a positive experience of education before school, they're much more likely to learn and be more willing to learn in school. Education is ultimately the responsibility of the government. World Vision does step in when needed to build classrooms, provide toys and books and educational materials. So that's another piece that we do. And finally, World Vision spends a lot of time in raising awareness with teachers. We actually train teachers in how to do child-friendly education, so to expand the way they teach. So why are we doing this? Why are we building schools and providing equipment and toys and games and training teachers? Why are we building awareness with parents and children? It's because we believe that education provides children a way out. It provides a hope for a future, and it gives them a chance at a better life.
So that's our newest project in Nepal. And for some of you who are child sponsors, you would know that this is our model when we go in and we try to meet them at their point of need. It's not just about giving old textbooks or old clothes. Because even if you give them the textbooks, they can't read English up to that level. So how do we see them at a point and meet their needs and beyond all the sweets and toys you give them that you feel good after you go there for a little while? How can we sustain that help in a way that really meets their critical needs, in a way that, as Liz was saying on the video, helps them in the long term to have that education, to be lifted out of poverty, so they won't always be like the second poorest country in the world. So the first 2 years we do the assessment, we see if what is the need, what's the health need, what's the water related need, the education need, and we don't replace the government, because the government has to do their job. But what we do is we fill in the gaps. It's no point to just have the building of the schools, but the children are sick at home with all the diarrhea and all the malnutrition, then they don't get a chance to go to school, even if you have the building there. So the next 3 to 13 years we implement with our different interventions, they were talking about training of teachers, etc. This is what we do, and year 14 and 15, that's where we phase out. Why do we do that? I think for World Vision, we are not about just hang out forever and ever. We are about how do we empower them, train them, help them to own their problems, organize them better, and help them to access the help that they need to help their children. And this is the reason why we would phase out to help other needy communities. So we help them until they are able to stand on their own feet, then we move on. And that is a sustainable model that has the impact that we are looking at in all these 5 key areas that David was talking about. So when World Vision does work, we say, oh, we help children. And then we ask ourselves, okay, year on year, is there an increase in the number of children that you help? These are some Cambodian stats. We drill it down to indices like enrollment in primary school and functional literacy. We look at proper diarrhea treatment, the access to proper diarrhea treatment, is that going up? How is that impacting malnutrition? Because you know, if they have food to eat but they are always purging, then all the nutrition is lost. And after that, you have anemic children, you have malnourished children, you have stunted kids. And child protection, I think you don't have to go beyond the streets in some of these countries to know that some of these kids are trafficked, some of these kids are exploited. Why? Because some are just driven by desperate poverty to do what they have to do in order just to have those regular meals and to help their parents. And we look at, in some of our contexts, the children in crisis, the number of child protection committees that are set up, the number of most vulnerable children who are protected, and economic livelihood. If we look at savings group, value chain development, business facilitation, how to protect their seats, how to introduce other supplementary sources of income so they don't just depend on only rice. Then when the weather goes bad, what, the children starve, the women suffer? What we do is, for example, in Thailand, we teach them how to do frog farming, catfish farming, how to plant the certain types of other vegetables which can have, which can provide crop yield and allow them to sell. These are just some other examples. Just now, David was talking about pollution. So we realized that the rice farmers, for the husk of the rice, how can we help them to grow their income in other ways? And we took the husk, packed them together, and taught the communities how to do mushroom farming. So this is where we empower the weak and the poor. I think for God, He gives us the resources. Some of it is just under our nose, but to organize it and to get the community going, to love them enough to say, hey, we will come alongside you, we will help you grow your income, so that you don't always have to be at the mercy of the weather. This is what we do in community development in Mongolia as well, and we're looking at indices where the households with one or more adults earning an income are increasing. So less joblessness. And the child sponsorship is not where we give the money to the child. Some people say, oh, you don't give the money to the child. What happened to the money? Did it go to a big black hole? No, it didn't go to a big black hole. What we do is we pool the resources together. So we build the health posts, the schools, the wells. Then your sponsored child can drink from the well. But the neighbor can also drink from the well. The neighboring, the child who is his or your sponsored child's neighbor can also drink. We feel this is the fairest way to reduce rivalry. So if you help one child to child sponsorship, you're actually helping the community as well. And also, if you give the money just to the family, how do you know the money didn't go to booze? How do you know the money didn't go to prostitution? In the end, the child didn't get anything. So these are different ways in which, when we put systems in place, we have our systems are audited by KPMG worldwide. And these are the ways in which we can reassure that everybody can help somebody. Of course, you can't help everybody, but everybody can help somebody. And how did the money go and help and impact the children? That is our job, to update you and to educate you and create awareness about what is sustainable and real help. So these are the various things that you receive. You can write to them and you receive a report on how they're doing. And basically, if we're working and walking God's way, I think there's a song about the rich will, the poor, they needn't fear so much about not being rich. I think everybody can have a little bit of God's will, and that's a fairer world. So it's not about charity, it's about justice. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Fiona, for the wonderful presentation. For those of you who are keen to contribute a good cause, you can do so later at the World Vision booth at the back, or if not, you can speak to their representatives. Okay, this evening, we are honored to have a speaker whose experience and background is well suited to deliver the first talk of the Wisdom Series in 2015. She is the director of the Association of Banks in Singapore, and most importantly, a woman whose heart is for God and His people. Let us hear from this accomplished veteran about wisdom in leadership and how she integrates Christian values in her daily work and life. I am pleased to present Mrs. Ong Ai Boon. Check.
Good evening, everyone. Good evening. And, Christine is here. And I've got where's Priscilla? Priscilla is somewhere. And some of my friends who are here. Thank you for coming. And it's a privilege for me to be here. And it's so nice to see so many men. So many men in your group. God bless you men, you know. Praise God, praise God. Okay, let me just, I want to start to talk about God being my CEO, not just CEO, but God being the God of my life, and how He has influenced me and basically my family too, since I received Christ 33 years ago. Amen. So, Father, I just want to thank you for this evening, for everybody who's here. So wonderful to see them, each and every one of them who are here, Father, to give up their evening to be here, Father, to listen to what you have for them even this evening. And I want to thank you, Father, for the work of World Vision. It is so edifying and it's so encouraging to hear of the good work that they're doing. And Father, you say, go forth, feed my children. And Father, truly, even the harvest is ripe for harvest, for harvesting. And the fields are ripe for harvesting. And I want to ask you, Lord, to bless the work and the hands of the people who goes into the field in World Vision. But in the meantime, Father, in Singapore, I just want to thank you that in Singapore, you are blessing each and every one of us in your own special way. And this evening, Lord, especially, I want to thank you for bringing us here. And I want to give you thanks for this opportunity and this privilege to be here to share with everyone your work in my life, how you have called me and what you have done in my life. And I pray, Father, that for what you have done for me, let it be a blessing to others even as you have blessed me, that they will know you as the one and only God who loves us, our Father in heaven. And thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ. By the power of the Holy Spirit in each and every one of us, we give you praise, give you thanks. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I want to amen that this evening I came after a very, very busy day. And I did tell my secretary next time, when I have a full set of meeting, maybe I should not take a speaking engagement because it doesn't give me time to settle down. But I was very humbled when I was just this afternoon just waiting on the Lord for a message. And I want to say that I am what I am today by the grace of God. And the verse that came to me was is in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 9, that says, because Paul had prayed and he talked about his weaknesses, and God said, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is perfected in your weakness. And therefore, Paul says, I would therefore rather boast about my weaknesses so that the power of Christ may dwell in me. Therefore, I'm well content with weaknesses so that, Lord, when I am weak, then I am strong in the Lord. And tonight, I come here humbly before you to tell you that although, yes, I have been working in the banking sector for the last 43 years, and now I'm director of the Association of Banks, the CEO of the Association of Banks. And I'm very blessed. I'm very blessed to see how God has blessed me with His favor, with His grace, with His guidance of me. That today I want to tell you, and I come here to tell you, that if today, by the grace of God, if I'm respected in my job, it is because there is Christ in me. And I want to thank God again how good He has been. And my life is a life where, you know, God has been guiding me all this while. And I dare not even boast of anything that I am good about. But I want to thank God that God made me fearfully and wonderfully made. That I have my own strengths, But in my strength, of my passion, of my motivation, of my dominating, of my driven self, I had worked since 1969 after I finished my university, and I have worked with a bank called Chung Kiao Bank, okay? Those of you in my vintage will know about Chung Kiao Bank. It has since been taken over by UOB after Slater Walker bought Haw Par Villa, stripped it off, and they had to sell it off because Dr. Goh Keng Swee then immediately said that no foreigner must own a local bank with more than 20%, and he had to quickly sell it off. And Mr. Wee Cho Yeo took the opportunity and he bought, and today is a very big bank, okay, today. And I saw that, and I worked there, and after that, with then my husband, my late husband, who has since gone home to the Lord, after his national service, worked in Citibank. And when he worked in Citibank, they had asked that the wife, who was working at the bank, had to resign because we are both in the same industry. And not by choice, I had to look for an alternate job. And I found the alternate job when MAS put an advertisement for offices, because Singapore was then being developed as a financial center. And the advertisement came and I asked Citibank, "Will you let me join MAS?" And they said, "Yes, it's okay." And because of that, by the grace of God, I joined MBS for 10 years, and during the 10 years, I've learned what it is to be a regulator and understood the mind and the thinking of the Singapore government in building a first-class international financial centre by letting in only good financial institutions of good repute, and at the same time have very strong governance and rules to ensure that Singapore's reputation, integrity, credibility, and the rule of law exists. So I want to thank God again. You know, the reason I'm thanking God is all this happened to me not by choice. Bo piang, they call it. You know, bo piang. I had no choice. It was like I was moved to it. And I realized as I look back how important it is to just go by your strength and your passion. And then at that time, when I joined MAS for the 10 years, you remember Dr. Goh Keng Swee came to MAS, and those of you been following the financial sector, okay? Dr. Goh Keng Swee came to MAS 1918, and he had the Times said it was a bloodbath. You know, he came and he got his men to interview everybody in MAS, and they had the whole list of officers they wanted to keep, and then he invited all of us to the then at the SIA building at Robinson Road, and he said, "Okay, all those names up here, these are the names that stay. Those that we draw the line, leave MAS." And it was quite a pandemonium there because many people were caught unawares. But I was kept in MAS, but because I then had my bosses, my seniors, removed by default again. By default, I became number two in the department. Not that I wanted it, but bo piang again, you know. My whole life, I'll tell you a lot of bo piang, you know. But God is good. God has been with me. Even though at that time, I did not know Him, but He knew me and He's been guiding me. And I'm telling you this because I can see the hand of God in my life. That's all I want to tell you. It's not that I was clever, I was not. It's just that by grace of God, God was with me. And I look back and now I want to tell you just very briefly my background in my career. So I stayed, and being number two, when your manager is not in your office, you got to go and see Minister for Finance, you got to go and see Dr. Goh, Kiang Go Tau Pei, okay? Scared, okay, basically scared, you know? And I felt prepared. It was suddenly taken away from me because I was number four. Okay, I was fourth before all that happened, and it's fine. Number four, you have a lot of shame, you know.
You allow share, you do work, you influence policy, you develop policy, you influence, but you have the covering of all your bosses ahead of you. So number four, in a hierarchy, very comfortable. You understand what I mean? Minky nanga, you know. I don't have to meet all these bosses, but enough in the background to do all that. But understanding all this. So when that happened, I realized, by the grace of God again, I told myself, more sama this one. You know what I mean? You better get off the stage when you know that I couldn't cope. Frankly, I couldn't cope with the pressure, with the stress. And at that point in time, my marriage was on the rocks. Because I was a workaholic. I worked and I worked and I worked. I love my job. I got such a passion for my job. And to make matters worse, I had a bad temper, I was possessive, I was dominating, I was controlling, I was authoritative. You wouldn't want to work for a boss like that, right? Anyway, that was what I was, to the point where my husband wanted to separate with me. And I realized that something was not right with me. But that was, at that point in time, situation where I had to find help. But in the meantime, I decided to leave MES. At that point in time, I decided to leave MES and maybe become a remiser, you know? Just don't work in MES anymore. And after I resigned, I got a call. I got a call from Mr. Chua Kim Yao, you know, from DBS Bank. And he says, look, Ivan, we are looking for somebody to head up the Association of Banks. I said, I don't want, I'm not interested in the Association of Banks, because that time, see the Association of Banks, no up. See no up. It was just in the shadow of, at that time, the chairman, OCBC. Because after the split from Malaysia, OCBC took over the chairmanship of the Association of Banks. And it was a sleepy hollow. So to me, it's go there for what, you know? I said, no, no, no. So I keep on turning him down. Then one day, my husband called me again. Nina, can you please take the job now? Get Chua Kim Yao off my back. And again, as a dutiful wife, since husband asked, Bo Piang, I took the job. I took the job to get Chua Kim Yao off my husband's back. Can you imagine? Not, and then I joined this and I didn't know, again, you know, I didn't know. But God began to develop me in the Association of Banks. So I'm there now for the 33rd year this year. Can you imagine? By the grace of God, you know. Okay, so what happened? What happened was God was actually watching over me, not knowing that in my heart of heart, when I was a young girl, I grew up in Fairfield Methodist School, okay? And I had an auntie, Ai, my mother's sister, Ai, Ji, who became a Methodist, and had a lot of objections from my family because her family, we are all Taoists, okay? For me, I grew up in Fairfield, and we have chapel. So we have chapel, you sing hymns, and you listen to the Word of God. Unknown to me too, at that time, we had friends, my father had friends who were Christian. I went with them to Sunday school. So when I went to Sunday school, it was fun. There were stories, then there are games, and then after eating, and then there are friends. I mean, to me, it's Sunday is a fun time, so I went. Unknown to me, the Word of God, singing the hymns and the Word of God were all the seeds of God planted in. And unknown to me then, I believed in Jesus as a young girl. When I was very, very ill, I still remember I was very ill. I prayed, I said, Jesus, I want to acknowledge you as Jesus. You heal me. And Jesus healed me. And you know, this is the wonderful grace of God. But having said that, I grew up not following after Jesus, but following my parents, my grandma, grandma, you know. All of them were Bailaoya, so I continued Bailaoya, you see, because my whole family, and then Baizhou somehow, you know, ancestor worship, right? You just follow. But nevertheless, my life, because I just told you, have you heard this called Ak Nang Pa Da? You all know what I'm talking about. You all guilty now. You understand what is up now, Pana. You understand, or David, what I just said? You don't understand. You're an OCBC, Onang China, Bukan China. You don't understand the dialect, or you don't understand dialect, period. Or you don't understand Teochew, okay? Aknang pang da means you're very fierce on the outside, but inside you're very soft and very scary pants. So basically that's me, okay? Tua pa hoi, you know? Tua pa hoi means you're like a crab with an armor on the outside, but inside the meat all soft. That's me, okay? That's me, tua pa hoi, you see? That's me. And because of that, I've always recognized that I'm not a smart person. I've always recognized that I am not a clever person. I've always recognized that I'm not clever. Okay? But, got down. I've got a mouth to talk. You understand or not? And also, the Teochew Nam sitting Sigma, EQ, EQ. Not so much IQ, but got EQ, you know? And when you have EQ, and EQ means 调作能, you know how to handle people, intuitively handle. So sometimes in life, a person who's not very smart like me can get along in life because he has zhou nang, you know? You handle people correctly, you know? So by the grace of God, again, I would say it's the grace of God. Although I had a very bad temper, although I was very strong, although I was very dominant, even I had a very bad reputation in MES. Those, any one of you who have friends who worked in MES during the 70s, you mentioned Ong Ai Boon, they say, oh my gosh, that tigers. I tell you, nobody wanted to join my division. That is the kind of rejection I was getting. And on top of that, I had a mother who is the perfect Teochew Anya. She's so gentle. She is so pretty. She is full of quite boy, you know, she's full of doing the right thing. That irritated me. And not only that, she never accepted me for what I was. She never accepted me. I swear kong boy piang. Ha such a way sai get out, I swear kong boy piang. That's how she scold me. She'll say, 36 years old, you've got 3 kids and now you're so young, you know? You haven't changed, you know? But I couldn't change because I'm born the way I am. I am like that one. I'm very straight. I am what I am. You see me what I am. I am what I am. But by the grace of God again, when the Lord called me, I changed. How did I change? I was born again in 1983 when I was so desperate when my husband talked about separation. And I realized that something is not right with me. Why? Because my husband loved me so much when he married me. Now, at 36 years old, he's talking about leaving me. I married at 24, now 36, 12 years later, he's talking about leaving me. And you know what he said to me? You gave me a wrong impression of yourself. Very thick up, you know, my husband. Thick up means yam gong. You speak Cantonese, right? So I can translate into Cantonese for you, okay? But he was so long-suffering. And some of you know my husband. So my name is Ai Boon, his name is Sir Boon. Seaman, okay? And he's so tall, and they call him a gentle giant. I'm anything but that, okay? My husband is 6-footer. Thank God I've got older son who's, I've got an older boy, 6'2", you know. By the grace of God again, I have to keep on saying the grace of God because I'm so thankful and so grateful that though I was so steep in my Waterloo Street and I'm a Teochew, so I go to the Tok Ai Gong Teochew Nang by Ni Ang Bong Si, by Lao Bia at Phillips Street. That was my regular. That was the temple that we go to. Just down the next door here, that one. And my uncle was the Ni Ang Kong Si's, official. So whenever they have big events, you find a whole family there. It didn't help. The long and the short is, Whatever religion I had at that time, I found couldn't help me. I wanted to change my temper, I wanted to change myself. I wanted to have a better relationship, not only with my husband. I wanted a better relationship with my children. I want a better relationship with my mother. I want a better relationship with my brothers and my sisters. I want a better relationship with my staff. I want a better relationship even with friends. Yeah. But I have some good friends say, yeah, don't look at Boon like that. When you really get to know her, she's actually very nice. Okay? You got some very loyal friends like that. But praise God again. I tried several other religions. Why didn't I want to choose Christianity? I tried Sai Baba, I tried Zen, I tried Confucianism, I tried various others, but I avoided Christianity. Why? Because at that time I was very critical of Christians. They say one thing, do another, and I call Christians all hypocrites. Can you imagine Christian cannot have a chocolate cake because it's brown color? The chocolate, the birthday cake must be red. I said, ayo, you're no better than me leh. Bantang, you know? You understand? They did not give me a conviction that Christian did not impress me. But I want to thank God that also that there were some very strong Christian friends whom in my heart of heart I admired. That they were very strong in their faith and they were very quiet. They did not preach to me. But it was a lifestyle evangelism that I respected. And to me, okay, this one can. You know, this one can. But Jesus Christ knew my heart. God of Jesus Christ, our Heavenly Father, is a God of relationship. And I didn't know that because my heart cried out for relationship. I wanted to change. I couldn't change. I went to John Ewing Chow. At that time, he was running the government, what is it called, up at Pasir Panjang, you know, Heng Mui Keng Terrace, ISCS, something with the government, to try all the management theory to change myself. Cannot change. The minute anybody say anything wrong or anything I don't like, yep, I fall, I'll come up. And then I said, what's the point? And I hated myself, my temper. I didn't like myself, I didn't know what to do. And I was actually lamenting by the grace of God. Jesus Christ came and called me. He came and called me when I didn't choose him. And he got a friend, Timothy Connie Xiao, to, and I don't know, in my vintage, anybody know Timothy Xiao, the architect who introduced to Singapore the masonette in the apartments, the upstairs, downstairs in the apartments, you know? And he's a beautiful, he's a very good architect. The wife was my mother's good friend's daughter and we grew up together. After a while, he had hepatitis B. And actually before my eyes, I saw him, quote unquote, dying. Every day he was just deteriorating and he didn't want to see anybody, but he allowed us to see him. And I could see him, my heart was thinking, ayo, don't know whether Timmy will last. And then one day, he said he received Christ, born again, at one of these teen challenge, you know? And I saw him grow and improve and gain health day by day. And I see my heart say, wow, this is real then. This Jesus that I knew from childhood is still a miracle worker. It impressed me that he's born again and he changed. So that touched me. And then, one day he took me and I heard Dr. Reverend Neville Tan. You all know Dr. Neville Tan? Don't know. He's an old man now. And he wrote the book called The Iron Man. You all must get hold of the book, The Iron Man. He was in the 50s, one of the top wanted criminals, gangster chief. He has done everything that should not be done and he's in high security prison. The long and the short is, in prison, he found Jesus Christ. His mother died. The mother was the only one who said, Zaya, le ho ho zo nang la. Ayo, le u jia bo. You know, in prison when he comes out, you know. See the mother, but next moment he snapped, he's in prison again, you know. And the only person who believed in him, who loved him was the mother. When the mother died, or dying and died, they won't let him out to attend the mother's funeral. He was so upset, he was so angry. And you know what? In the prison, they give them, they issue them Bibles, right? And he was in a state of pain and pressure over the mother. And suddenly in prison, he said, his testimony is that a verse came to him. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. And when that verse came through his mind, he said, there was such a wonderful peace that came upon me that I remember when I was in St. Patrick's School, he said, that this was something that I read and I want more of it. But he couldn't say anyway, the Lord is my shepherd, and he couldn't continue. And he knew it was from the Bible. And you know, in the prison, they issue Bible, but they tear up the pages and roll and smoke a cigarette, right? He took the Bible, couldn't find it. He was so angry, he took it and he threw it with all his heart against the wall. And then the Bible picked up, opened up. And guess what it opened up to? Psalm 23. I tell you, it takes only God to do that, okay? And then he read, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He read on and he wept and he wept. He said, there and then he met with Jesus, because Jesus met with him at his point of need, at his point of his weakness. And in his weakness, when he called out for the word, and you must know, Jesus Christ is the word of God, became flesh. And he became born again that night. On his knees, received Christ, and he became such a model prisoner. He studied and became a, got his doctorate in prison, okay? Gaumutima, like that, I tell you, so amazing, only God can do it. In Christ, I can do all things because Christ strengthened him. And then he began to preach to all the other prisoners until he had to be released, because he became a born again. To me, when I heard his testimony, I said, ayo, 糟糕啊. That time, I'm a Taoist. As a Taoist, you must do good works, because I don't know whether, how many sins I got left when I meet Nyam Nok Wang. And then I had to go through the Tapo Jige, the 18 gates of hell, depending on how many sins I got left over. But to me, and my religion then is, if I'm in prison, I have no ability to do good works. I can't do anything to negate my sin. It is sailor. That's a savior. I mean, it's really savior. You know? But this Jesus Christ came and met Dr. Neville Tan in prison when he is down, out, gangster, useless, scum of society, and Jesus came. That was revelation to me. And in my heart of heart, I really wanted to meet Jesus Christ personally. I didn't want Christians. I wanted to meet Jesus personally. And you know, those of you, as I share this, those of you in your heart, okay, like me, just desire to meet with Jesus, one to one, okay, to see whether he's real or not. That's the heart's desire, because God is a very personal God. This Jesus Christ is a personal God. He deals with you according to your need, according to what's in your heart, you understand? And he heard this heart that wanted to restore relationship, a heart that wanted to meet him. And he came and called. Too long a story to tell you, but he called. Through Timothy Xiao, inviting me to a home cell. And in the home cell, there was this not Nigerian, he's Ghanaian, black like midnight gun from Ghana, Pastor Yao Usu Aucha. And he was with the Haggai Institute. He was studying, so they met him. And in our group, there was a whole group of us. Before they were born again, every other Saturday, we were merrymaking, drinking, eating with a group of us, you know. But praise God, you know, one by one, after Timmy and Connie received Christ, another CT, I will receive Christ, you know. In that group too, Paul and Peter Sia also received Christ, and several others. There was such a revival in this group. But Ong Ai Boon not yet, nah, and Ong Ho Chai not yet. You see? And God already, praise God, okay, already eyed the two of us. Thank God he did, okay? So, That night, I went to his house and he said, today I want to talk from John 15, that God is the wine dresser and you are the branches and he's the true vine. If you don't bear fruit, he'll cut you down and throw you in the fire. Scared the life out of me and scared me into heaven. I was so afraid. I already told you I was very afraid of the 18 gates of hell. Go and see Hoppa Bida, okay? They'll show you all that happened. You tell lies, they cut off your tongue. You say any wrong motive, they pull out, they bowel you and throw you into oil, and then the truck rolls over you. All these were horrible images in my mind as a child that went to Hoppa Bida to see all these images. So to me is, in my heart of hearts, I tell you what I wanted. I wanted to be able to hear Jesus tell that criminal hanging on the cross, tonight you're with me in paradise. I wanted a guarantee of eternal life, that I don't have to do any good works because I know I'm so wretched, I'm so lousy, I'm so wretched. I scold people, I shout at people, I do all the wrong things, nothing good in me. I told you, nothing good in me. I wanted this assurance of an eternal life that only Jesus can give me. And that was the desire in my heart. And so when he spoke that, I said, oh my gosh. My husband was also minister that night. So we said, let's go to church on Sunday. Let's go back to church. My husband said, okay. We were going back to Barker Road Methodist Church because that my husband's an ACS boy. And as an ACS boy, he was from Barker Road Methodist Church, so go back to the church. Anyway, that was a church we were married in because although I was not a Christian, I wanted to be married in church because I'm very romantic, all bright lights, okay? And I also thank God for Reverend Richard Ong who allowed my husband to marry a non-Christian and allowed that. And I believe God honors all this. God says, if you're not against me, you're for me. Amen. So you're not against church, I'm not against all this work, the Lord must be, I'm with God, like, amen, except that I don't like Christians, but I've got nothing, no issue with Jesus Christ, okay? Praise God. My children didn't want to go to Barker Road. My children wanted to go to Connie and Timmy's church called Trinity Christian Center at Adam Road. And you know why I had to go there? Because on that Sunday, Naomi Dowdy was preaching. He said, today I want to talk to you from Deuteronomy about this God who made heaven and earth, who created the stars and created and put the earth and created rocks and trees. Why do you want to build idols made of rocks and trees that I created and bow down to them that cannot help you? Why do you want to look at stars that I put in place and see astrology? Why do you want to see feng shui? Why do you want to see po kwe? Why do you want to see all this? Because I'm the Lord God who give you a future, give you a hope. I'm the one who's the God of your future. To me, it's, oh my gosh, he's talking about me. I was doing everything, all these things from fortune telling to feng shui, you know, I was a little bit of a pseudo feng shui, you know, friends will ask me, why my business so bad? I said, okay, let me go and see. Ah yeah, you must close this door. You close this door, your business, true enough, close door, business prosper. Because there is some spiritual law, but it is not of the Holy Spirit. Therefore, now I know. It is not of God. It's not of God. It's from the kingdom of darkness. That time, Christian tell me this is darkness. I say, yeah, like you Christian are always like that. So critical and judgmental, you know. But when my eyes were open, when Naomi Dowdy started to talk about it, guess what? The Shekinah glory of the Lord, the golden showers fell on me. It was like Tinkerbell and Peter Pan. And as the golden showers fell on me, I heard chains being broken. It was just being broken, and when that happened, I felt 200 pounds lighter. I came out of service and I was, oh my gosh, I felt so light, you know. So Timmy and Connie said, wow, Boony, just now we were praying and praying that you don't stand up and shout at the pastor. I've done it before. Because the pastor was describing everything that I was doing and my friends knew. So I said, wow, I must go and know more about this, you know. What is this falling down, slaying? First time they all clap, they dance in the church, then they speak in tongues, a language that I don't know. What's this? Because I'm Methodist, my background. This is charismatic, you know. And the long and the short is, one of the group of friends, one of the couple in our group who also just got born again, Siti and Aimun, invited us to a house for a cell group with full gospel. So we went and I asked all the questions that I want to ask about Christianity. And I was so satisfied. I said, wow, you answered all my questions. Some of you may know Tan Tuan Seng. Tuan Seng was the one who handled me. I said, this Sunday I go to church, I think I become a Christian. They said, no need, you can be Christian now. No need to wait now, here. And that was October the 23rd, 1983. At almost midnight, you know, went back to the home of Siti and Aimun and said the sinner's repentance prayer. At that time I said, Lord, truly I'm a sinner, I really need help. I receive you as the Son of God and I thank you for the blood at Calvary that washes away my sin. I thank you. Where's the cross? This is what it's all about, Christianity. That Jesus Christ on Calvary died with me, for me, and he washed away my sin. I was cleansed that night. And when I said the sinner's repentance prayer, suddenly a very tall fluorescent light, very tall, 8 feet tall at least, was so bright, walked right into me. And that was 33 years ago. And that night, I was born again. The peace the world cannot give me. The peace the world does not understand. The peace that surpasses all understanding. Walked right into me, and I want to thank God. After that, the Lord, to me at that time, it's me and Jesus Christ and God. The Bible became alive. And all of a sudden, I was so hungry for the Word of God. I read the Bible literally day and night. Not enough of it, I was so hungry. And the Lord showed me the cross. So I told the Lord, Lord, it doesn't matter what the cross means. All I want you is restore my relationship. Not realizing that Jesus Christ has called me. Deny yourself, carry your cross daily, and follow me. And the other thing which God showed me was this. He said, now that you're born again, you're in Christ, you have a spiritual unity, and it's no longer you who liveth, because when Jesus Christ died, your old man, your bad temper, your unforgiveness, your everything that is not right with God has gone to the cross with Jesus Christ. So when Jesus died, all my old man died with Jesus Christ. The identity, the spiritual, cosmic identity. And now God says, when you look at me, he sees me in the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Walk therefore as much as possible in the identity Christ in me, the hope of glory. And that was the only way I could overcome my bad temper. But in the meantime, you know, my temper was still there and I could still remember. Here I am when I'm speaking, and by the way, I talk so much. I couldn't stop talking about Jesus Christ. Until my friend said, look, when you go for lunch, can you don't talk about Jesus Christ? I said, if you don't want me to talk about Jesus Christ, don't come for lunch. If you come lunch with me, I'm talking Jesus Christ. I was just overflowing with Jesus. You cannot stop talking. They said, wow, I do very tiring like listening to you. So God knew that. So what did he do? He started a Monday lunchtime fellowship for me. So up to this day, for 32 years, it's been going on every Monday, okay? For me to talk. Talk about what? Talk about what God does with me every week. It's not just knowing the Word of God. It is applying and obeying the Word of God. How you apply the Word at home, in the office, wherever you go. Yeah? And then he started a ladies' fellowship for me at home. Every Thursday. Now it starts about 5:30. So that I can talk. Because God talks to me every day. And when he talks to me, in the meantime, let me tell you one. When I talk, I'm under anointing, I'm very nice. But after I come out of the talk in the office, anybody do anything wrong, you're going to cut your hand again. You're quite hard on me, manifesting again. So I come to a point where I say, Lord, no fun. Under a anointing very nice. Then outside anointing, you know, the temple still there, the quick to hear, quick to speak, quick to anger still there. Right? I should be quick to hear, slow to speak, slow to anger. But not yet, right? So I said, Lord, I complained to God. I said, God, if you don't want to change me, forget it. I don't want to preach. I don't want to speak. I don't want to do anything. And as I took issue with God and talked to God, you know what God told me? I Boon, I want to build you and grow you into an oak tree. I don't want a tauge. Toya, you know, toya grows overnight, but no roots. I'm going to grow an oak tree out of you, the planting of the Lord, that He may be glorified. So for the last 32 years, I have to remember my identity. So every time, for the last 32 years, I tell you, I had a problem with my mother, right? Angry with my mother, wow, kiss here. Sent to the cross, die daily, every day. Every day sent to the cross and try and stay here. And then my mother is so cute, but she understood this concept. So when both of us argue, he says, okay, my talent, my talent. Now we'll pull my talent, my talent. Do you know what she's saying? He says, don't talk, our old men are up. Because don't return evil with evil, but return evil with good. Evil with good is you don't get angry, right? So when two persons are angry, stop. Don't talk anymore. Send your old man to the cross. Don't just go and drink tea, play tennis, watch TV, go shopping. Don't just do that. But while you're shopping, playing tennis, whatever you do, send it to the cross. Send it to the cross. Send it to the cross. Because although Jesus Christ has already taken away all our sin, and the anger of God has totally melted on Jesus Christ, and Jesus Christ absorbed all of God's anger and wrath against the sin of mankind that was given, that came upon mankind through the disobedience of Adam. Now through the obedience of one Jesus Christ, we have received the righteousness of God. It's the obedience of Jesus Christ, you see? And what I saw is, my Father in heaven no more angry with me at all. He loves me. He loves you. If you receive Jesus Christ, and if you can identify with the death of Jesus Christ, God is no more angry because all His anger has gone on Jesus Christ. That now, praise God, He doesn't. We are no more sinners. We are totally cleansed, white as snow. That now, whenever you do wrong, there may be consequences, but humble yourself, confess it to the Lord Jesus Christ, and the Father says, "Follow my word," and the word of God I follow, praise God, will cause me to be more and more like Jesus Christ in experience. Are you following what I'm saying? That daily I have to walk in identity in the name of Jesus, that there's therefore now no condemnation for me in Christ Jesus. Praise God. And that's what's been happening. And this is what I did in 8 years. Okay, I had not expected to stay there for 33 years. I don't know how long more I'll stay there. But I'll stay there for as long as God doesn't tell me to leave. The minute God tells me to go, I'll go. So many people have asked me, when are you going to resign? I said, I will only leave when God tells me. Amen. Because that is where God uses my workplace to hone me. Because at home, being what I am, I've got such a strong say at home that God can't use my home to mold me and to hone me. God must use the office with all the government, with all my bosses to be able to hone me. And I was so angry with my mother, but because the Lord says, honor your father and mother. So I keep on honoring my mother. Angry with her, sent to the cross, honor my mother and father. Honor, throw the old man to the cross, but honor my mother and father. So at the end of the day, thank God, you know, my mother saw me change. You know what she said? Boom, ah, look, piang, yo, eh. Le nam bo kia kui bo kia, le kia got it. She said, you have changed. Now, you're not afraid of people, you're not afraid of devil, you're only afraid of God. Fear of God now. And then, one day, I heard her say, Fua, I want to be more like I do. Hallelujah. Wonderful. And she's 94 years old, she's living with me now. I've taken her in since I'm free, you know, since my children are all overseas, and then my husband has gone home to the Lord. And my relationship now with my mother has been restored, but it took almost 20 years of dying to self-love. Because there was so much anger and pain and unforgiveness in me, resentment, bitterness. But the Lord taught me, in the fear of the Lord, to obey His word, carry His cross and follow me. Same thing, my husband, okay? My husband saw me change. Because the word of God in 1 Peter 3 said, wife, submit to your husband. Wow, beta hang there, wife, submit to husband. But the word of God says, submit to husband. And God is not only CEO in my office, God is CEO in my life. And then the second thing God taught me was, one day, Tan Ju San, economist of UOB, I was complaining to him about my chairman, okay? He turned around and said to me, he said, I do. Romans chapter 13 says, you have to submit to authority, you know. It was like God right into me. And after that, what, quite. I don't quarrel with my bosses anymore. I become more manageable. I don't know how many of you know Alan Ng, formerly GM of UOB, okay? He was my chairman. And when somebody asked him, so how's the association when they come together for meeting? He said, everything is fine except the uncontrollable director it was. That was my how I was. But after I learned that in Romans 12, 13, you have to submit to all authority. Even I have to submit to my husband. But I told God, but God, I'm still right, my husband wrong. How to submit? But the Lord says, will you submit to me? I said, yes, Father, I'll submit to you. Then you submit to my word. What does my word say? I said, your word says submit to your husband. He said, then you submit to my word. So I didn't submit to my husband. I submitted to the word of God. And the word of God says submit to your husband. So I submitted to my husband. Amen. And when I submitted to my husband was so shocked. He was so kind to me after that. And then because he was kind to me, I also became nice to him. And because I'm nice to him, he became nicer to me. And then after that, I became nicer to him. And we became very nice to each other. Praise God. But to me, I was nice in the fear of the Lord. The word of God says so. And this word is forever settled in heaven. Men, we are like, and women, mankind, we are like grass. And the bright ones, the clever ones, like flowers. But they die, we pass away, become history book. Okay, great men and women become history book. But when we die and we are with Jesus Christ, can you imagine whatever you do unto God and give God the glory? In everything you do, in deed, in word, do it in the name of Jesus, giving thanks to the Father through Him. Whatever you do that. And unto God, not unto men. And when we meet with Jesus Christ, He'll say, good and faithful servant, you get your reward in heaven. There is a life after death. We are going to meet with Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ will come back. And oh, thank God, 58 years old, my husband on my birthday sent me 100 red roses. And I still got his card, and it says, totally in love with you, hubby. You think he was in love with me? I knew he wasn't in love with me. He was in love with Christ in me, the hope of glory. I died. Better still, my Osman, who worked 42 years in the Association of Banks. He worked in OCBC. And then when Malaysia split, he joined the Association of Banks. So he was there. But first and one and only job, 16-year-old until he retired. You know? A few years ago, he retired at 16. You know what he said? Wow, Mrs. Ong, dudu, I want macam harimau. But sekarang, so awak sudah tukar macam kucing sekarang. Do you understand, David? You don't. So. My Osman is my Malay messenger boy who is 60 years old, 50 years old. Before he retired, he said to me, Mrs. Ong, when I first met you, you're like a tigress, but now you're like a cat. So I said, but Osman tak cukup. Saya mau lagi tukar. Saya mau macam anak kucing. I want to be like a kitten. Because cat, you rub the wrong way, the claws still come off. And I still, now and then, but less often. And I don't claw so hard, I claw like that. Last time I was, I tell you. That's what I used to do. But they say leopards don't change spot. But Jesus Christ came to transform me by the grace of God. To transform me to be more like himself. And so, you know, in the Bible it says, you know, he permits all things to work together for good. That we, according to his purpose, you know, and to those who love him, that we be transformed into the image of his son, Jesus Christ. So at that time I said, Father, I'm transformed into the me, Jesus Christ. How do I look like? I do. I make you a woman. And by the grace of God. A woman is very important to God. In the spirit, woman and man, we are equal. But there is an order in God. In first, the word of God says, God is the head of Christ. Christ is the head of man. Man is the head of woman. And children are to honor the father and mother. That's the, as the Teochunam says, that means everything is in order. When there is the order, but that doesn't make man more important than woman. It's just the order of God. And since then, as a Christian, I've learned, after God told me this, what's in God's heart. I try not to scold men. Last time I stood, what do men can cry? So terrible, huh? But now, you must respect the man. Whether the man is right or wrong, beside the point. Being a woman, the Bible calls us a weaker vessel. And men, you are supposed to love your wife so that your prayers are not hindered. Amen? Remember, love your wife, okay? Amen? Okay, I think I'm going to stop since it's raining 9 o'clock. I had not expected to share this, but somehow the Lord put in my heart to share this. And praise God. When my heart is right, my work in ABS also right. Because God works from the inside out. I couldn't change my outside. There's nothing I could do to change myself. But now I thank God. He has changed me from the inside out. Amen. David, can I hand the session over to you? Who hands over the session? I hand it over to you. Praise God. Okay, I just want to give God the glory. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Ms. Ong.
Oh, I'll take a seat. Never mind, I stand with you. Am I supposed to be up here? For Q&A, I stand with you, okay?
Oh, you're also invited. Okay. Thank you, Mrs. Song, and for the inspiring speech and for wonderful sharing. You know, I was at the back, I thought, wow, so fast finished. I thought it's just started. And
you
really,
don't tempt me, okay? I can start talking to midnight. Don't tempt me, okay? Talking is not my problem. Not talking is my problem.
Listening is also not my problem. So, with a good doctor and a good listener.
So gracious, amen.
Amen. Okay, so without further ado, can I invite also David on stage to facilitate the Q&A session? David, please. David. Okay. Okay, I'm sure many of you have questions to ask Ms. Song, and please take this opportunity to hear it from her. Come, can we have the first question from the floor? Anyone? Yes, oh, this lady on my right, Dennis, in white.
Ms. Song, we are very impressed with your talk tonight.
Don't be impressed with me. It's not hiding with you, but I pray that you just got the blessing. Amen, okay?
I don't have a personal question for you. You can choose not to answer if you choose to. How old are you, if you may ask?
Chatjong mo to zao le. You understand
how to say? I understand your chip, but I understand what you're talking about.
Chatjong mo to zao le.
Very good, very impressed.
The only question is you want to know the age, Okay, right. Thanks for the question, right? Okay, right. Well, probably Sister Ivan will probably take another few more questions. Anyone? Yes. Anyone would like to ask anything from what she has said or things beyond what she just mentioned? Yes, please. Can we have the mic over there? Thank you.
Hi, Hi, Mrs. Ong. I just have one question for you. Since you have been so knowledgeable and working for so long, when you're serving God and you're also working, serving men, and you have to submit, and in the course of the work, sometimes the work does not necessarily it's not necessarily in the line of submitting to God, because the men, the bosses that you need to submit to may not be godly. So during those times, how did you cope? Submit? Don't submit?
Bosses are there. As I said, I learned to submit to authority. And I've learned, when you talk to bosses, you talk in submission to their authority. And you talk with EQ, you talk nicely. Sometimes to my staff, maybe not so nice, but the bosses talk nicer, okay? You are less patient with your staff, but you are more patient with bosses, okay? And the other thing is, when you deal with bosses, I realize, whatever you don't know, don't go home, don't bluff, and don't, you know, say things that you don't believe in. So what I do is, I don't know, I don't know, okay? There was a time, but anyway, I'm so effusive with Jesus Christ that I want to thank God that even at meetings, sometimes we can't come to a decision making. I'll say, now I know why why God sent Jesus Christ, the only Son, the one and only Son to save us. Because if they send a committee, Ong Ai-Boon won't be saved till this day. Because they can't make up their minds. So they know the stand I take. I make no qualms about the stand I take as a Christian. Amen. And I have not known of any difficult situation that conflicted with my belief. Because all my decision making is based on the word of God, and the word of God, that none of them had told me, stop talking Jesus Christ. That's one. The other one was, one of my chairman asked me to buy a dragon to give away. Now, I've learned this. The Lord convicted me about dragon as a symbol of the dark side. It is satanic, it's demonic. But this is a revelation that came to me. I asked God to reveal it to me. So when God revealed it to me, I will not handle anything that is God. Demonic, dragon, okay? Because I'm in the kingdom of light. The Bible says the kingdom of darkness, the symbol is the dragon. So I wouldn't, as a personal conviction. So one of my bosses, we had a visitor, and he said, go and buy the zodiac. The year was the year of the dragon. So asked me to buy a dragon to give it away. But you know what God has taught me? Many people know I have a very strong stand about dragon. How many of you know that the $50 bill during Dr. Goh Keng Sui's signature, there's a dragon at the corner? Do you know that? There's a dragon at the corner. So they teased me and said, Ai-Boon, you know, there's a dragon on the $50 note. Then you better give up all your $50 and give them all to me. So I went to God, I said, Lord, yeah, all this $50 note or $50 dragon, does it mean therefore I cannot use, you know? And the Lord said, no, it belongs to the currency board, it doesn't belong to you. So when things that don't belong to me, the responsibility on the person who owns it. So when my board asked me to buy the dragon, I had to obey, because it doesn't go against the fundamental of giving up Jesus Christ, right? It is just an act against the conviction. But when my boss asked me to do it, I do it because I could be submitted to authority. So I bought the dragon and sold God. I said, I really wish I don't have to give this. Hey, so wonderful. He came to me on that day and said, Ai-Boon, I hear you're a Christian. You all don't like dragon, right? Okay, I tell you, I'll take over the presentation from you. So he took over and did the presentation. That's about the only thing I can think of where it conflict. But other than that, there is actually no conflict, you know. So if you can give me an example, I'll tell you how I deal with it. Because to me, there's no conflict. I tell you what, when there's a conflict, you pray and ask God to give you the anointing. I don't have the time to share about a conflict that I have. Now that you mentioned, it was to deal with Koh Beng Seng, who's now the chairman of Great Eastern Life, and how God taught me how to obey him, and therefore, as a result, caused the salvation of a man. That's a long story. If you want, we can have lunch and I'll share with you. That's a beautiful story, you know, of how I submitted 100% to the Lord, to the point where, you know, Koh Beng Seng asked me to relieve Betty Ed's guy from the job, you know? But I couldn't, because when I was in the room, the Lord said, Peter Rowe's soul is more important than ABS. You dare to go and take back the job? I didn't dare, because God spoke. So to me, the word of God is more important because he's my CEO. He may be the regulator of MES, but he's my CEO. Amen, David. This is what GIMC is about. God is my CEO. So he's my CEO, my ultimate. He's the one that I obey. So I humbly, he asked me, did you take over the job? I said, no, I didn't. Why? I said, because God said, cannot take over. You know why? Because God spoke to me in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 4 or 5. He says, your wisdom should not, your faith should not rest on the wisdom of men, but on the power of God. So I said, Lord, I depend on your power. This power is to believe that God, in Romans 4, 17, believe that God is the one who calls into being that which does not exist and gives life to the dead. That is the power of God that I have. That I have to believe that I go and tell the regulator, the most fearsome regulator at that time, in the 80s, that I did not obey what he told me to do. So he said, okay, since you didn't do it and you said God did it, I'm going to hold you responsible. So I told him, I told God, God, I'm going to call on you. You better make sure this is done properly. And by the grace of God, it was done so beautifully that it was done on time. It was done. And Mr. J.Y. Pillay, the MD MES, needed to fly off to Switzerland with that book that I was supposed to produce, you know, and at a night flight. And the book came at 5 p.m. that day, okay? And I said, Lord, so what do I tell this destiny? The Lord says, tell them, Jeremiah 1:12, that I watch over my word to perform them. So there is this conflict. But when there's a conflict, you talk to God, and God is the one who's going to guide me all the way through with his rhema word. Okay, you know what I just said? You just do that, and then hallelujah, God is on your side. If God is with you, who can be against you? Amen. Yeah. Sorry for the long answer to your short question.
No problem. You have a question, right? That lady. Okay, right. Who would like to ask the next question?
Wow, so far the ladies only ask the questions.
Maybe a man can try asking something. No, good.
Hi, Ms.Ong, thank you for your anointed sharing.
Thank you.
I'm a new believer for 1 or 2 years, and I'm going to be baptized on the 21st.
God bless you.
So I'd like you to give me a suggestion of what to expect or what to look out for.
What to expect to look out for? Okay, I'll take you offline, okay? Give me your contact number, I'll take you offline.
Which church
do you go to?
NCC. New creation.
Oh, what the star. Church. Okay, praise God. At the star, right? Eh?
Correct.
Yeah. You're going to be born again. You're baptized. When you're baptized, you identify with the death of Jesus Christ. And you're resurrected with the new life of Christ in you. Amen. So walk, therefore, in the newness of life, not in the oldness of life, giving God the glory. Amen.
Thank you. Amen. Thank you.
Right, good. Maybe we'll do one more question. Yes. Right. All right.
Yes, I still have my home cell. It's still going on.
Oh.
God, unless the Lord tells me to stop, I cannot stop. This is belongs to the Lord. It doesn't belong to me. The Monday fellowship is in my office, 1 to 2 every Monday. And then home cell is at home. Home cell only ladies. Ladies issue.
Home cell, Betty here.
Oh, Betty. Oh, the Betty of all the cakes.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh, Betty. Oh, God bless you. Yes, it's still on. I still remember your kicks. Nice meeting you. Praise God.
Good.
I have two questions. One for Mrs. Ong, one for you.
Sure.
My first question for Mrs. Ong is, your mom now converted the baptized Mrs.
Of course! Ayo! With a daughter like this, don't convert, man! Sorry,
Sorry. I just want to be sure.
Yes. She received Christ. And at her baptism, she said, I saw my daughter change. Nothing can change my daughter. But my mother, after my mother received Christ, she went to talk to her 84-year-old mother, my grandma. And my grandma was a Taoist, had to live in the son's home because when they die, the son must do all the answer, you know, all the joysticks and everything. But she, my grandmother couldn't get along with the second wife, you know, of my grandfather. And she was so unhappy. So when my mother went to share the gospel, and my mother told her that when you're a Christian, it doesn't matter where you die, straight away go to heaven. So it doesn't matter where your body is. She said, Dad, I want to be a Christian. So my grandmother became a Christian at 84 years old. Although Kui Hook, you know, she is already in a black dress, you know, the Buddhist black dress, Kui Hook already lah. So baptized are technically their own baptism of whatever it is. And she came to live with us in Singapore from KL. And praise God, she began to, my grandmother is educated, so she read the Bible. And she said, Boon, what she said is, one day when she was reading the Bible, a voice told her that she got 12 sins which God has washed away. So she said, from now on, I must not sin. So she began to forgive the second wife of my grandfather. Forgive. Huh? And so wonderful, when on the night before she died, she said, Bunga, you know what I just said or not? Praise God, to God be the glory of it. David, you know what I said, right? My grandmother, 89 years old, on the night before she died, she said, thank you for introducing Jesus to me, and I'm going to heaven already, and heaven, the roads are all paved in gold. I go there and wait for you. In the meantime, you how how do the gold. That's my grandmother. She went home to the Lord. Amen.
This is,
amen. Any one of you here who have not received Christ yet?
Let me try.
Anybody has not received Christ yet? It doesn't matter. Nobody is going to zap you. If anybody, will send the Holy Spirit to zap. Anyway, those of you not putting hands, we just pray, Lord, that tonight, whatever has been shared, it's to your glory. That, Father, you touch the heart. And it is in situations like this that you have touched me. And I pray that, Lord, you, your desires for everyone to come to this wonderful saving grace of knowing your love, knowing you, that we can have that eternal life with you. So, Father, I release the anointing upon each and every one of my brothers and sisters here, especially those who do not know you. And for those who already know you, Father, stoke the fire of the Holy Spirit that they will grow in their spirit man and grow in you, in Jesus' name. Sorry, you got a second question for David.
Okay, David, your example, just earlier you talked about the Euro 4 engine, those distributors had to use. And if you're in the same shoe, the position in China, you're one of them, you know?
Yes.
What would you do?
What would I do, right? Am I the buyer or am I the seller?
Well, you're the distributor, and what would you do? You are the...
Right.
Yes.
Okay. I think, to me, it's... somebody, people may not believe me, I'm real. I'm a person that I think in my last session I spoke about this. I'm a person. When I walk to the side of the road, and if the traffic light is a red man, means I should not cross. Even though it's midnight, there's no car at all. It's always safe to cross the road because there's no car at midnight. I will still be standing there until I see the green light. That is me. But you may not believe what I say, but it's real me. Yeah? That's why I say I always have a problem going to China. Because when I'm always in China, I'll just be standing there. People are rushing across the street. Then they say, this must be Singapore now. Standing there waiting for the green man. No, but this is real me. So in the first place, if I know the industry has this problem, right? They're all selling fake Euro 4 for Euro 1 or 2 or that. Then in the first place, I will not enter the industry. Because I cannot, so-called my layman term, right? I cannot sleep well, you know, in the night. This kind of money, I won't make. I will only do things in God's way because He has shown me so much miracles in the last few years, even though I'm a young Christian. So I know Fearing God is the beginning of wisdom. So I will fear Him. I will fear Him. I will not do things that is against His words. That is for you to believe, but that's real inside me. Yeah. Thank you. Thanks. Yes.
Thank you. Yeah. Sure. I just want related to this question. I just follow up.
Yes.
Tonight's topic is wisdom in leadership.
Yes.
And entrepreneurship. Yeah.
Yes.
And
yes.
Wealth creation.
Yes.
In which case, where is the wealth creation, and we don't see this wisdom in leadership in today's topic.
Yes.
I mean, if it's going to be Mrs. Ong, whether you're going to speak. This is the topic today, and my friend asked me. He came to attend this meeting because this friend invited me and invited him.
Sure.
So where is the wisdom in leadership and entrepreneurship and the wealth creation part?
Okay. I think...
Where is the wisdom in the world?
Okay.
There's no wisdom yet.
Maybe I'll share my views, then maybe Sister Ong, Ivan can also share her view. Now, when we say wisdom in wealth creation, it's not about... it must be a session. That you come in, we teach you, you do A, B, C equals the money. Okay? A lot of things that we learn in life are means of creating wealth, building your wealth. And I really truly enjoy what Sister Ong has shared with me today, the last one. Where in there, I thought, hey, like what Dixon said, oh, why don't we continue for a longer time? I really learned a lot, and all these are values. When we practice it in our life, wealth will come. It may not be a direct thing that, oh, you must do this, then it's equal to profit. But these are things that we make sure we take care of all this in our lives. Wealth will come. Wealth will come. And especially if you're a believer, you will agree with me. If we practice God's word, He will take care of the rest. He will take care of the rest. Yeah. And that's my view, and maybe Ms. Sister Ivan would like to share with you.
Since you talk about wisdom and in leadership, what I found out is Jesus is the wisdom of God. That is what the word says. And when I talk about dying to myself and walking in Jesus Christ, in Christ Jesus, I have the wisdom of God. And the Bible, I use this as my, it's my Bible and I live by it. And the Bible says, the wisdom from above, not earthly wisdom. The wisdom from above, this is found in James chapter 3, verse 17, is first pure, and then peaceable, gentle, reasonable, full of mercy and good fruits, unwavering, without hypocrisy. When you have all these features, when you yield, you find that your wealth comes, quote-unquote, through very good relationship. And relationship and friends, better than the money that you have without friends. Having friendship and the ability to help a friend in trouble and to help him come out of trouble and to be able to see God and bring peace upon him to make him change his mind. I've got this architect, he was an architect, and he went through the 1990s financial crime, and I met him at the Maxwell Road. Is it Fairfield? No. Is it Fairfield, the one to Maxwell, next to Maxwell? So I was there, and he was architect, and his house, a value of something like 2.8 million, 800,000 bona fide, you know, because it's a buyer's market, you know, and he was so desperate. But what we did, we prayed with him, and we gave him the glory of the Lord. We gave him the scriptures. And praise God, when he found the wisdom of God within him, that money and house, you don't have to commit suicide, okay? Praise God, when he had a mindset change, suddenly he changed, and now he sold his house and lived in an EC. He had enough money to buy an EC. He had peace in his heart. And when he had peace in his heart, the next time when I renovated my house, he was a valuer from an architect, he became a valuer from a government department, and he had so much joy. So to me, brother, I want to tell you this. Money is not everything. Making money is not everything. To me, when I was at 36 years old, my husband then was heading up a bank. We had a lot of money. We had credit cards. We had cars. We had all the C's that we had. But two of us never had peace because our hearts were not right. But after my husband and myself were born again and we became Christians and really walking born again Christians in the Lord, You don't need much to have the joy of the Lord, and the joy of the Lord becomes so wonderfully wonderful that it's worth much more than any physical things in this world. That's all I can tell you, and you can only taste it when you walk in it. That's all I'm going to tell you, that by the grace of God, I am so blessed today, having less than what I had, but I have so much more inside for eternity. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Hope that friends, hope that you can join us more often in the future. Now, class, can we have a big round of applause for Sister Ivan?
To God be the glory. Amen. God bless you.
I'm really impressed that she's 70, but she talked like 40, right? Another big round of applause.
Thank you, Mrs. Ong, for addressing the questions, and David for facilitating the Q&A session. May I now invite David to present a token of appreciation to Mrs. Ong. This token of appreciation is actually a book. It's titled God is My CEO, which is also the name of this non-profit organization. It was this book actually, the title inspired David to actually name the non-profit organization. So may I invite David to present this token of appreciation to Mrs. Ong Ai Boon. Thank you, Ms. Song and David. Thank you. Thank you.
This is for nearing 70, okay?
Awesome. Well, nearing 70. It doesn't seem like nearing 70, you know. Because after nearing 70 and yet a day full of meetings, appointments, so busy, and yet she still can talk. It's really amazing. Mrs. Song, you can really talk a lot. Can we, ladies and gentlemen, give her another big round of applause, please? Thank you. And may I now invite David to lead us in a closing prayer. David, please.
Friends, for those who are comfortable, please join me for a short prayer. Father, thanks for this platform that we congregate here to learn words from you. Father, we pray for your strength and wisdom that we being leaders, entrepreneurs, managers, employers, or employees, we'll learn from you that we can actually build our wealth in your way. And we will also have this wisdom from you that we do realize that we are just caretaker of all our resources. All our resources are from you, and we'll learn to contribute back to your kingdom and to help the needy. Father, in Jesus Christ's name, we say thanks and we pray. Amen. Amen.
Thank you. Just a second. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for taking time to attend this event. I hope you gain insights and are encouraged to apply the way of Christ in work and in life. As some of you might know, GIMC is self-funded by Mr. David Poh and a few sponsors. We are at the beginning of stage of building up this organization to advance God's kingdom. If you appreciate and have benefited from the events organized so far, do help us in ways you can, either in cash or in kind. If you'd like to make a donation, you may do so at the registration counter at the back. There's a donation box which you can contribute any amount. If you'd like to contribute in other ways, please feel free to let our GIMC staff know. And also, do visit our World Vision booth if you have any inquiries about sponsoring a child or the less privileged. Lastly, we are also in need of volunteers so who can assist us in various roles like photographer, MC, IT and admin. So if you are keen, you can also register at the booth behind. And finally, since Mrs. Ong is here, it's a very rare opportunity that we can invite her here. For those of you who require a prayer, you can do so after the session later. Feel free, come forward. Since she's here, make full use of this opportunity to pray for yourself, family members, and as well as friends in your office, in life, and in work. Okay, once again, thank you all for attending this event and see you all in future. God bless. Thank you.